Now recognize one of our own on the Rules Committee and a Subcommittee Chair on the Appropriations Committee, Congressman Tom Cole.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, Chairman Stivers and Ranking Member Slaughter, for the opportunity to testify today regarding the proposed reforms to Rule 21 and the modern authorization and appropriations process. As a member of the Appropriations Committee, the Rules Committee, and the Budget Committee, I look forward to discussing whether changes are needed in the current House rules to make the appropriations process better. I find myself in the unusual position as an appropriator of arguing against non-appropriators who want to enhance the power of the Appropriations Committee. I actually joked to my good friend Mr. Price earlier, if we're going to become the new Ways and Means Committee, maybe we could take over those splendid Ways and Means Committee rooms and just swap out where we do our humble work. But as many of you are aware, the appropriations process is vested in Congress by Section 9, Article 1 of the Constitution. Enacting annual appropriations is something the Congress must do under the Constitution. It only follows that House rules providing for consideration of these bills should help, not hinder, the enactment of appropriations bills. One of the largest challenges the Appropriations Committee faces is the decline of the reauthorization process. As we all know, and several members have stated, the CBO reports that $310 billion in funding was provided in the FY16 budget for programs whose authorization had lapsed. In response to these challenges, there have been thoughtful suggestions, some by my colleagues testifying here today. One suggestion is amending Rule 21 to create an additional point of order on appropriations bills that would require unauthorized programs to be left unfunded or frozen as a way to incentivize the authorization committees to enact authorizations. In my opinion, these proposals have serious downsides. First of all, I do not see how additional points of order on appropriations bills will serve as an incentive to authorization chairmen to move their authorization bills. The target's being put on the wrong back. It's also unrealistic to expect that Congress will not fund our national security while awaiting a defense authorization bill, or that Congress will shut down funding for the National Institutes of Health for lack of an authorization, or that no increase will be provided for veterans' health when an authorization isn't moving for whatever reason. The net result would be more pressure on the Rules Committee to provide additional waivers to these new rules. In addition, these changes would create obstacles to rapidly responding to emergencies and would disadvantage the House in relationship to the Senate, which did not have similar rules. If the intent is to incentivize the authorization process, then proposals should address the authorizing committees, not the Appropriations Committee. However, if the intent of the proposed amendments of Rule 21 is to ensure that no objectionable unauthorized programs are funded, there's already a process to prevent this, the so-called Army Protocol. Currently, every appropriations bill is sent to the authorizing committee before being considered in the Rules Committee. If the authorizing committee objects to funding for an unauthorized program, it can already be exposed to a point of order. Rather than expanding additional points of orders that are not likely to achieve their intended purpose and likely to make the appropriations process more arduous, we should focus on making sure the Army Protocol functions as intended. Another set of proposals recommends changing Rule 21 to make it easier to amend mandatory programs on appropriations bills, including a proposal to reinstate the so-called Holman Rule, which was removed in 1983. This rule would allow changes in existing law as part of an amendment to reduce spending in an appropriations bill. These proposals would significantly expand what amendments could be offered on appropriations bills. They would allow appropriations amendments that are legislative in nature, including how agencies and programs are staffed, structured, and compensated, things that are directly under the jurisdiction of the authorization committees and involve permanent changes in law. It would diminish the roles of the authorizing committees, make them less central to the legislative process, and at the same time, make it harder to pass appropriations bills. It would involve appropriations bills in more controversies and increase the number of amendments to appropriations bill, which has already exploded in recent years. In 1982, the last year the Holman Rule was in effect, there were 59 floor amendments offered to the 10 appropriations bills brought to the floor. Last year, there were 456 amendments proposed to the 7 bills that came to the floor, an 800% increase. I shudder to think how long it would take to consider an appropriations bill with a whole new category made in order of amendments not necessarily related to discretionary funding. In conclusion, I believe that any changes in Rule 21 must be carefully considered. We should consider proposals to change Rule 21 to determine if they will help us achieve our shared goal of the enactment of the annual appropriations bill. From my perspective, I'm concerned that these proposed changes will not necessarily address the real challenges that their sponsors seek to change. At the same time, I'm certainly willing to work with my colleagues to identify changes that will make the process work more smoothly and will ensure that the authorizing committees do their jobs. Thank you, and I look forward to answering any questions you might have.